How do I create and use public keys with SSH? Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Before we even begin, if you have no clue as to what SSH is or why you would even care, this video might not be for you. This video has turned out to be basically very popular over the years since I first wrote its companion article a long time ago. So I wanted to update it and demonstrate some of the things that I'm doing. But this really is for folks that are interested in using SSH. SSH is the secure shell. Essentially, it is a command line tool, or actually a Windows, it can also be a Windows tool, that allows you to connect to a remote server securely, hence its name, via the command line or shell. It's used heavily in the Linux world. In fact, it's what I use to connect here from my Windows desktop to my Linux servers. AskLeo.com runs on an Ubuntu Linux server, and it's SSH that I use to connect to its command line. Now, there are a bunch of different SSH clients that are available. PuTTY and Secure CRT are two. There actually is an SSH command line client. I think it's built into Windows, but it's in one of the things that can be installed with Windows. And there's also SFTP clients. SFTP is essentially file transfer protocol, FTP, based on the SSH protocol. So it uses the same infrastructure, but it's targeted at file transfer rather than interactive interaction. SFTP clients include tools like QtFTP Professional, CyberDuck and Mountain Duck, WebDrive, WinSCP, WSFTP. Again, there are going to be a bunch of others. The thing to look for if you're evaluating an SFTP client is the phrase SSH, SFTP, or, and especially for both the SSH and SFTP clients, public key authentication. Personally, I use PuTTY and Mountain Duck heavily, almost every day. So, generating your keys. Well, let's go take a look and I will show you how this is done. So here we are in Windows 11. I'm going to show you using PuTTY. If there is kind of a base tool that pretty much everybody understands, that's available everywhere, that just works really well, it's PuTTY. So that's what I'm going to use for my example. Some of the other tools that I've listed and some of the other tools that are available can do what we're about to do, but they'll do it in different ways and maybe even have a little bit of different terminology. This is mostly about either showing you how to use PuTTY or at least showing you the concepts involved. Now, this is the PuTTY website. You can actually get here via putty.org, but it actually then sends you to this person who actually is the official repository for PuTTY. And what I've installed for my machine is the 64-bit x86 MSI installer that installs all of the PuTTY tools, and it actually puts them in the path so that they're available right away. I'm going to close this because now I'm just going to Windows R to run. I'm going to run a tool called PuttyGen. PuttyGen is what you use to create public keys. Actually, you're creating a key pair. So you've got this dialog up. We're not going to do anything to any options or anything. We're just going to hit generate. And you'll notice that it says, please generate some randomness by moving the mouse over the blank area. You and I are the most random of people. Randomness, as it turns out, is a very, very important part of secure cryptography. And it's also really, really hard to generate truly random information automated. So that's why they have you do some kind of interaction, because even though we all might do things like draw circles or whatever, the pixels will be off. None of us are going to be drawing exactly the same pixel by pixel random pattern on the screen. So it's extremely random and is a very good source for randomness for what they're doing. Anyway, what we've done so far is we've actually generated a key. So there are a couple of things that you can do. Key passphrase. Remember, This is public key authentication. So we actually have two things we care about. One is the public key. That's up here in this upper window, and we'll save that in a minute. But then there's also the private key. This is the key that you keep secret on your machine. One of the additional layers of security that you can provide is to specify a password on that private key. That means that when it comes time to use the private key, you'll have to specify that password again, but it'll just be a password, and then you'll get on with whatever you're connecting to. So in this case, I'm going to use a really, really bad password called password. First thing we'll do is save the public key. Now, in my case, OneDrive has gotten its fingers into my system, and by default, my documents folder is going to be in OneDrive. I don't like that. Especially for the public key, that's fine. But in a moment, we'll find out that what we really want is the private key to be private. That means we don't want it uploaded to cloud services. So instead, I'm going to go directly to my users and the documents folder that was there before OneDrive got its fingers in there. And I'm just going to call this leo.pub. That is the public key associated with this key pair. Then I'm going to save the private key. And once again, I'm going to save it in the local documents folder. You'll notice that it says PuTTY private key files.ppk. This is the default format for keys created by PuTTY. Now, what's nice about this is a lot of tools have standardized on accepting this as the key format if you ever need to. So I'm going to save that. I'm going to do one other thing, and I actually recommend you do this as well, because the PPK format, while it is popular, it is not 100% ubiquitous. So what we're going to do here is in the conversions menu, we will export OpenSSH key. And this time I'm going to call it leo.key, because it's a key. That is the private key. That is the key you need to keep in a safe place, because it is literally the key to your kingdom. Let's have a quick look at exactly what those files look like, just so you get an idea. I'm going to run Notepad here. First thing we'll open is the public key, because this is something that you actually will perhaps want to open. We'll take a look at it, and you can see that it's basically a bunch of, as you might expect, data. It is encoded RSA public key. This is what you would give to the owner of the server to which you are requesting access, to which you are setting up this kind of authentication. There's another approach that we will use also to get that public key to them, perhaps in a format that's ever so slightly more useful. But bottom line is, if you can think of nothing else, this is the public key that you would literally make public and give to anyone else. I'm in a new tab here. I'm going to now open, and I have to go back to all files, leo.key. Remember, this is the private key. And you can see, again, this is an RSA private key. It's text encoded. This is what you end up needing to keep safe and secure. And then just for completeness, we will go ahead and open up the PuTTY file. And you can see that it has a bunch of additional information. Ultimately, what it contains is both the public and private key. And what's interesting about the private key is that it, I believe, also contains the public key, or the public key can be derived from it. So that is something that if you save only one thing for yourself, this is the thing you'll want to save. For completeness, save them both. In fact, save the PPK if you can at all. But this is what's inside of those files that you're saving. So now, what do you do with it? Well, remember I said that you want to give the key to the server owner. If you're connecting to a Linux server, this key up here may actually be a little bit more useful. You'll notice it reads public key for pasting into an OpenSSH authorized keys file. This is actually in the format that your server owner might want. This allows them to just copy paste what you give them. I've just copied it to the clipboard. This allows them to then just paste this into the appropriate location for the account that you want to connect to. I will go ahead and run Notepad again so that we can see that even though this is the public key, it looks a little different. What you can't see here because of the length of this line is that it's actually a single long line. That's what your server owner is very likely to want. So what I'm going to do right now is save this also. And we're going to save this to I'm going to call it leo2.pub since it's in that different format. And poof. Now, I'm going to pause the video, put on my server owner hat, and install that key on one of my servers so that we can see how it gets used. I'll be right back. Okay. I have installed the public key in the magic place on the server to which I want to connect. Now, let's connect to it. We're done with the PuTTY key generator, so we'll go ahead and close that, and instead, this time, we'll run PuTTY itself. The host, or the name of the computer that I'm trying to connect to, is a local machine on my network. So this is not a machine that you would be able to connect to worldwide on the real internet. This is local, but the same concepts are all going to apply. If you had some other machine with a real domain name associated with it out on the internet, this is what you would do. The other thing then that we would specify is down here in SSH under auth credentials. We'll browse and go to where I've got the .ppk file stored, and we'll use that. Now, we'll just say open. Now, the very first time you connect to a server is a special time because the server provides a key, a signature that allows you to, in the future, confirm that the server you're connecting to is the same server you were connecting to in the past. We're going to accept that. Log in as Leo. My private key has a passphrase, so I need to specify that. And I'm connected. Now, that's using PuTTY. GUI interface. However, there are other interesting ways to use PuTTY that sometimes might be a little bit easier. I'm going to run command.com or command.exe, I guess. And this time we're going to run PuTTY, the program we care about, dash I for identity file. And what I'm going to do then is simply point that at the .ppk file that we created. And I'm going to say leo at Noten 2023, which is the name of the machine on my local network. And we'll hit enter. This time again, it needs the passphrase for security, but that's all. And we're connected. Now, one final step. And that is simply to point out that the passphrase on your private key is optional. Depending on your faith in your own security, if you don't have a passphrase, it won't ask for one. What that means then is that when I run this command line, which you might want to save as a shortcut or a batch file or something like that. When I run this command line, it doesn't prompt me for anything. It just connects to the server. Boom, just like that. Very, very handy. Now, I mentioned FTP earlier. PuTTY comes with a secured SFTP program. It's called PSFTP. We will do this way. L is my username, dash two forces a protocol, dash I, once again, the location of the PPK file, and then the server. So this is an FTP program, not an interactive program. Do that. Again, it wants the passphrase. Boom. We now have a secure FTP connection to this server. The only passphrase that I had to specify was the password to my secure private secret key. And as I said, even that's optional. So that's SSH and PuTTY and the SSH terminal and PSFTP, the SFTP program. I hope you find this useful. I hope you find this helpful if you are in the world of SSH. For updates, for comments, for links related to this one and more, visit askleo.com/2391. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.